It's been over a week since the country's tycoons resubmitted an unsolicited proposal to rehabilitate the Nino Aquino International Airport amid a tourism boom. The airport has been voted as the worst in the world several times, and just this January and May suffered power failures that grounded flights and stranded thousands of passengers. For more on the country's airport ambitions, we speak with a member of the Manila International Airport Consortium, Cesar Consing, President and CEO of Ayala Corporation and Chairman of AC Infrastructure. Hi, Cesar. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning, Mimi.
All right. So, Cesar, have you heard back from government yet?
Not yet officially. I think we're in a bunch of meetings. I hope they'll take a look at our unsolicited proposal because it's a very high-value proposal.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a timetable at least?
No, the government sets a timetable, Mimi. We're simply waiting to be informed. But we're very excited to get started. We can get shovel ready pretty quickly.
Okay, so let's start with a proposal. $4.8 billion. That's essentially $3.8 billion to build or rehabilitate the airport. And $1 billion goes to government, right? Just so they will give this deal to you. Is this how it really works? What does that $1 billion going to do when it gets to government?
Well, let me look at this in, let me put this all in terms of pesos, okay, so that it's easier for us
all
to look
right
at the numbers. We're talking of a 57 billion peso concession payment to the government.
Okay.
And at the moment the government receives that, you know, it goes into the budget and they can do whatever they want with it. And obviously, we're running a government budget deficit, so this will help fill that deficit. And then in the first 5 years, the consortium proposes to spend in CapEx an additional 57 billion pesos. Okay, that's for the first 5 years. And then from year 6 to 25, because we're asking for a 25-year concession, we will be spending another 154 billion pesos. Mm-hmm. So that's a total of 268 billion pesos.
Okay.
Now that 268 is just a fraction of the over 800 billion pesos in economic value, in net economic value, that we believe this airport will generate, okay? Mm-hmm. Because when you add to this 268, another 280 billion pesos, which will represent the government's share in revenues and taxes from the airport, and then you add an almost equal amount, 258 billion pesos, which we believe will be the net economic value from tourism, passenger comfort and convenience, aircraft decongestion savings, items like that. So the 268 billion that the consortium proposes to spend for this 25-year period is literally just a fraction of the over 800 billion pesos in net economic value that we think will be created.
Mm-hmm. And do you think, why does this make good economic sense for the investors, for the six conglomerates who are putting in the money?
Well, you know, for the six conglomerates, each conglomerate's only going to have somewhere between 11 to 12%. I don't think it will make that much of a difference from the standpoint of each particular conglomerate. But we all think that we would all benefit from a better airport. We're hoping that the better airport, remember, this is the gateway to the country. It is the first stop for a tourist or an international traveler. A better airport will basically lift all ships. It will lift the standards all around. Everybody will benefit. So that's where we think the real benefits are.
Mm-hmm. It
isn't in just being part of this concession, because we all have a fairly small piece of it.
Mm-hmm. Cesar, for those who have been following this story and they know that this used to be just 100 billion and now it's 268 billion, what are the key differences? What did you add?
There really is no key difference. The 268 was the number from the beginning. What I think got picked up early was just a combination of the concession agreement and probably some of the CapEx in the initial years.
All right.
The numbers haven't changed at all.
All right. If you look at the NAIA, the main gateway to the country, I'm going to play devil's advocate here, Cesar. Isn't this like beating a dead horse? I mean, we're spending so much on an airport that can no longer be expanded. I mean, the fundamental issue we all know is that we need extra runways. NAIA just has two. Even if we upgrade or rehabilitate NAIA, you won't be able to add runways, and the core issues will remain.
Yeah, Mimi, I beg to disagree.
Okay.
NAIA right now has a capacity of, call it, 31 million passengers per year. We believe that even with one runway, just one runway, we can increase that over a 25-year period to 70 million passengers a year. As a matter of fact, we actually expect some of those increases to come fairly quickly. In the next few years, we'll probably get it up to more than 50 million passengers a year. The one runway need not be an absolute constraint. We can still work with that one runway. We're working very closely with Gatwick, which GIP, which owns Gatwick, and Gatwick is the most efficient one runway airport in the world. And they're approaching 55 million passengers a year. So that one runway need not be a constraint.
Yeah, because many will question, you're gonna increase passengers, you'll probably increase flights with the same runway. And now, you know, we're experiencing all of these delays because we don't have enough runways. Will that mean worse airport experience for many of the flights?
We're experiencing all kinds of delays for a whole host of reasons, mm-hmm. not just because we have one runway. We believe
but that's a that major
no, I don't think so. We can double the capacity of this airport with one runway, all right? Mm-hmm. So if you go in there thinking that you can't do any more than one runway, I think you're sorely mistaken, sorely mistaken. We can actually do a lot more. We can more than double the capacity of this airport with this one runway. Mm-hmm. Better management, better systems, better facilities, right? We can do so much more with the airport we have today. We have to run it better. We have to build it better. We have to process passengers better. We just have to be better.
Mm-hmm. The infrastructure, that two runways that we have perpendicular, one is for a big aircraft, one is for smaller aircraft. I wonder, because right now we're following the Australian system that's 40 movements per hour, takeoffs and landings. Do you think, so you honestly believe we can increase the movements without compromising, you know, speed and efficiency?
Well, the plans we're looking at now have us going to 50 movements and more in a few years, and frankly, bringing that all the way up to 70. So those are our plans.
Okay.
And it's not the consortium members that figured this out. You know, our GIP, which is the expert in this, has figured this out, and they're doing it already in Gatwick.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Cesar, you're an investment banker. I'm very curious. I'm pretty sure you've studied the numbers and you're looking at all of the options. Why do you think upgrading NAIA is the best solution and not focusing on maybe building infrastructure that will lead to other airports outside Metro Manila, perhaps like Clark?
You know, Mimi, we've looked at airports in large mega cities, right?
Okay.
And if you look at the dozen or so large mega cities in the world, and Metro Manila is one of them, almost all of them, and I think everybody else I saw on the list of about 12, were served by more than one airport, right? Some of them two airports, three airports, four airports, five airports, right? London, for example, is served by five or six airports, okay? Mm-hmm. We need more than one airport.
Okay.
We're not looking at NAIA and saying, look, forget about all the other airports. We're just saying we need NAIA because mm-hmm. come 2048, 25 years from now, the projection is 140 million passengers a year, right? And we've just said that we could probably get NAIA up to maybe 70 million passengers a year over the 25-year time frame. So guess what? We need other airports. Mm-hmm. We need other airports. NAIA is just one. Mm-hmm. NAIA is just one. We're subscribing to a multi-airport strategy. Oh. And our view is very simple. We have an airport that's functioning now. Let's fix it. Let's make it better. Let's get it more efficient. Let's allow this airport to help in the country's growth.
All right. One more question. Since you mentioned, you know, other mega cities with airports, a lot of the big cities actually don't have airports so close to the metropolis. I mean, Hong Kong, they have it in a different island. London, Manhattan doesn't even have its own airport. I mean, you travel far for airports. There must be some wisdom in having an airport not so close to your major cities. What are your thoughts on this?
I'm sure there's some wisdom in that. Yeah, by all means, build the airports, you know, further away. We need more airports. But right now, we have this airport. Right okay. now, this is the airport that's standing, right? Mm-hmm. What do you propose to do? Shut this down and then build afresh? Mm-hmm. I think that's silly, right? Mm-hmm. Right now, let's build with what we've got, and then let's do more.
Okay. Are there plans for this consortium to pursue other airport projects after this?
Well, we have no idea whether we'll even get this concession, right? So let's start with this.
All right.
We just want to make things better, Mimi. Mm-hmm.
All right. Cesar, you did say 25-year concession. That's what you're asking for. But government initially saying they want 15. Why? Why the difference in the numbers? And why do you think 25 makes more sense?
You know, if you look at airport concessions around the world, we're looking at non-EU concessions. You know,
okay.
almost 90% of non-EU concessions are in excess of 20 years because there is an understanding that airports are long-term assets, mm-hmm. that airports need long-term investment, right? They need long-term plans, all right? These airports, they run for decades, all right? Mm-hmm. A 15-year concession is just too short to justify the amount of money that is needed to get this airport up to speed. You have to remember, very little money has been spent on this airport for years and years and years, mm-hmm. right? We're not only starting from zero, we might be starting from negative. Right? So we're playing catch up.
Playing catch up indeed. Cesar, I want to push you a little bit on this, the timeline. So you have submitted the proposal. When are you expecting more or less to hear back from government? And then since it's unsolicited, there will be a Swiss challenge, correct?
There will be if the government accepts our, okay. our proposal. I don't know when the government is going to respond. I hope they do. Mm-hmm. You know, I think they understand the issues. We sorely need an airport. You know, we have so many Filipinos traveling. Think of the number of OFWs that we have. A bad airport is a tax on Filipinos.
Mm-hmm. Is a tax on Filipinos. Okay, when you do get the approval, when you do get the original proponent status from government, okay, assuming that you do get it, you'll have a Swiss challenge. When you get this project, how long will it take you?
To what?
To start, you know, before to start work and before we start feeling the... Okay, shovel ready, you did say.
We don't own the timetable. The timetable is owned by the government decision makers. Mm-hmm. But if in their wisdom they give us the project, we'll start immediately.
All right. We're all looking forward. We're going to be watching this space. Cesar, thank you so much for joining us and for sharing with us more about the blueprint for the Philippines airport ambitions. Thank you, sir. See you soon.
Thank you, Mimi. Thank you very much.
All right.